Good morning to everyone. If there are announcements that you need to make, you may make them at this time. Go ahead.
Good morning. I was called and told that the funeral for Miss Rosalie is going to be Tuesday at 2 o'clock, and they are meeting after the funeral at the Tribal Center for a meal. So I just want to let everybody know so folks will bring food for the funeral for Tuesday at 2 o'clock. Thank you.
Good morning. I'd like to remind those who would like to sing in a choir on Wednesday night to meet after the worship service in the sanctuary, if you would do that, please.
Good morning. The Thanksgiving service will be Wednesday at 7 in here, and we will be collecting an offering.
Good morning, church. We will have youth group tonight or this evening at 4 p.m., so any teens 13 to 18 can meet us in the sanctuary at 4 p.m., but let me know if you do plan to attend just so we can get a head count for food this afternoon. Thank you, and thanks so much for everybody who supported me during the last couple of weeks and supported my family. The love for y'all is definitely overwhelming, and I just appreciate and love each of y'all so much.
Thank you.
Good morning. Christmas is just around the corner. If anybody would like to help decorate next Friday, I would really appreciate it. We really need some men. We will be doing decorating, gathering around 8:30 to 9 to start the decoration.
There are no more announcements. If not, we'll stand and sing our opening hymn, "You Are Worthy of My Praise." Let us pray. Father, as we call upon that precious name, dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the many, many blessings of life. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for food and for shelter, for rain and for sunshine. But above all, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son that has died upon the cross, that through him, Heavenly Father, we may receive eternal life. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would bless each one that is here today. Heavenly Father, we pray that we will all get a blessing when we leave this afternoon, and help us, Heavenly Father, as we strive to do the things that's pleasing unto you. And Heavenly Father, I'd like to thank you for our offering that was raised this morning. And Heavenly Father, we know that it'll be used for the uplifting of thy kingdom's work here on earth. Guide and direct us now, Heavenly Father, as we further wait before thee. So we thank in Jesus' name. Amen. And Holy Ghost, all You may be seated. I'd like to thank each one that has come this morning and welcome you all, and that today may be a good day and a blessed day for all of us. And at this time, we're going to ask Sister Robin Stewart to come with the children's church.
Day knows it. Okay. Whoa. We'll have to let Day lead that next time, right? Because Miss Robin doesn't know that. Good morning. How's everybody? Yay? Okay. You're what? Triple good. Wow. I wish I was that good. That's wonderful. I don't know about the rest of the adults, but right here before Thanksgiving, I'm a little nerve-wracking trying to get everything done. Okay, well, Mr. Reggie and I have been away for 2 weeks, and I just want to tell you that I missed y'all, and I am so happy that we're back home with y'all, okay? So let's talk about the word Thanksgiving. Okay, it's a compound word. How many people know what a compound word is? No? Okay, the teacher's coming out in me. Compound word. Compound means that it's a word, but it's got two individual words in it. What two words are in Thanksgiving? Which one? Thanks and giving, right. So, and sorry, I have to read this morning because I'm just a little scattered. So let's talk about those two words. So thanks. So Thanksgiving is coming up. Who would you be saying thanks to this week, or maybe even more than just this week? Aubrey? Friends and family. Yes. Layla?
The Lord.
The Lord. Absolutely. Anyone else that you'd say thanks to? Yes. Aubrey? Your cousins? Absolutely. Sage? Huh? God. Yes. Yes, there's a lot of people that you would be saying thanks to, correct, right now. So let's talk about giving. How about giving? Giving. Anybody want to think about giving? What about giving, honey? Give presents. Absolutely. Sage? Food? Yes. Is that what she said? Food? Yes, good. Layla?
Give love.
Give love. Elena? Absolutely. That's what I was getting at. That's good. To do something for others, to give of yourself for others. Yes. Aubrey? Give hugs. Yes. Aren't they the best? Hugs are the best. Okay, so when we give thanks to God for all that we have, right? And this Thursday, definitely we should be thanking Him we should be thanking Him every day, though, right? We should be thanking Him all the time for what He gives us, for what He does for us, for just being in our life. The flip side of that is giving, okay? So we should tell people, we can give them the message and tell them what God does in our lives. That is giving, okay? You can give to other people. You can give presents in the way of doing special things for them, right? To giving to people when they need help. to serve others. So I want you to, I'm going to read a Bible verse to you. You ready? And you have something to do in this. So listen up. So I'm going to read this Bible verse. I'm going to read it twice. I want you to see if you can hear the three reasons why we should say thank you to God. Three reasons you're going to hear in this Bible verse. Are y'all ready? Okay, listen really carefully. Okay, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. Listen up, here you go. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. It's Psalms 100, 4 and 5. Now, can you hear three reasons in there why we should say thank you to God? Elena, what's one of them? His love endures forever. Wonderful. Layla? Huh? His faithfulness continues. Good, good, good. Sage? His heart. Okay, Lord is good, right? Okay, so listen to it one more time and see if we got them all. Ready? Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Did we get them all? Yeah, I think we did. Good job. Y'all give yourselves a hand. Good job. Okay, I have one thing that I want to show you, and please don't laugh at my Thanksgiving tree. I mean, it's supposed to be little. It's supposed to be branches, but don't y'all laugh at my Thanksgiving tree. This is my Thanksgiving tree. So I wanted to show y'all something that maybe you could do. You have some time off from school in the next few days, right? So what you do is you get, is Dad laughing at my tree? Oh, Darren's doing it. He started it, didn't he? I know you're not doing it, Dad. He probably started. Okay, so take some branches. Just go in your yard and find some branches. Put them in, it was supposed to be a mason jar. I couldn't find my mason jars in my house. I don't know where they are. But you can put some, all of this is Dollar Tree. All of this is Dollar Tree. You know I love the Dollar Tree. Put these little pebbles in the bottom. Then you can get this green moss, okay, Dollar Tree, all of it. Go find some branches. And then I did these little clips. They were also Dollar Tree, but they were easy. You can do all kinds of things to hang things here. These all have reasons to be thankful. You could add one a day. You could grow this tree to be lots of branches and lots of things that you're thankful for. So mine say things like family, mama, dad, friends, school. You are thankful for school, right? Oh, no, come on. Y'all need to be thankful for school. Pastor, church. Okay, so just something that maybe y'all could do at home when you have some time off in the next week or so. It's really fun. I'm going to keep this at home. Reggie doesn't know it, but I'm going to have him add some things too. Darren, hopefully he'll put Robin up there, but we'll see. things that you are thankful for. Okay, do y'all like that? You think that's something that you might want to do? Okay, take your parents to Dollar Tree. You can get it all right there. Okay? I have a little bit different prayer this morning, and I want to see if y'all will help me. So this is a prayer where I say the words and you say them after me. Would y'all like that? That way all of you pray. Are you ready? So I'm going to say the words and you just follow me. Okay, here we go. Dear God, thank you for all of your amazing blessings. And the work you do in our lives. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you for your love. We love you, God. Thank you for Jesus. In his name, amen. Thank y'all.
At this time, I'm going to ask Sister Muriel, would she come and have the prayers of the church? And if someone you didn't get on the list, and you can mention their name, and she will go from there.
And while Muriel was coming, I got a kind of a praise report and a thank you at the same time. Yesterday, at the corner of the field out here, somebody decided to throw a cigarette out and set the ditch line on fire. Justin Jefferson came through, was trying to put out with the water jug or whatever, and Sharon Wynn called the fire department. So I want to personally thank those two for quick thanking, because it could have got real ugly around here yesterday. So Justin Jefferson and Sharon Wynn, I know it could have been some more, but I know those two were there and stayed around. So thank those two folks.
Good morning. Do you have any praises or prayer requests that you would like added to our list before I pray? If so, if you'll state them now, please.
I have a prayer request for Ashley.
How do you spell the last name?
W-R-E-N.
Okay. Any others? I will read the names and then I will pray. Earl Herndon, Marion Herndon, Amador Sanchez and family, the family of Mrs. Rosalie Adkins, Uncle Alva, Billy Castle, Leroy and family, Gaynell Grubbs and family, Mike Simmons and family, Ken and Glenda Douglas and family. Thank God for his daily grace, mercy, and provisions. Tanner, Alice, Anthony, and baby Taylan. Gary Deskin, Sheila McGill, Bev and Terry Bell, Becky Armstrong with stage 4 cancer, and that's Bill's sister. Jim and Helen Burgess, Kelly Carter, Angela Watson, Vicki Maybush, Lucille Bradby, Peggy Shaler, Holly Gifford, Morgan Gifford. Robbie Hogg will be having back and neck surgery tomorrow. Michael McEwen, we are to be in prayer for Israel. Dolly Adkins and Roger Wynn, who has COVID. Any unspoken prayer request, the homeless, depressed, lonely, incarcerated, and as Herman used to say, the brokenhearted mothers, Dalhart Adkins, Leroy, as he brings the message today, Ashley Wren, and we're thankful that the student who was choking last week is doing okay. We're thankful that there were people in place to assist him. Dear Heavenly Father, as we call upon your name, dear Lord, we're asking for your blessings, dear Heavenly Father, but we're thanking you for the blessings that you have given us also. We're thankful, Lord, for the praise reports that were mentioned this morning, dear Heavenly Father. We're thankful, dear Lord, that the fire that was out back on the church property, dear Heavenly Father, was successfully extinguished, dear Lord. We're thankful for those who are in the
right place at the right time. Dear Heavenly Father, you know the needs of those that were mentioned here this morning. You know the needs of those who are on the back of our bulletin, dear Lord. It just seems like our list grows longer and longer. But with our request, dear Heavenly Father, that these needs be met in you, we're also offering our thanks and our praise, dear Lord. We just pray, Lord, that you would comfort those who need comforting. We pray for healing, dear Lord, where healing is needed. And may we realize, dear Heavenly Father, that oftentimes the healing does not come in the form that we wish. It may not come in the time frame that we wish, Lord, but we know that all things work together for the good of those who love you, dear Heavenly Father. And we know that your time is the right time. May we always be mindful of that. We pray for world peace, dear Heavenly Father. We know that you are in the midst, dear Lord. But we pray, dear Lord, that the peace will begin within us. That wherever we go, dear Heavenly Father, that we will be a shining light to lead others to you, dear Lord. Again, Father, we thank you for your blessings. We pray, Lord, that you would just be with those who will be having surgery this week. Be with the doctors, the nurses, dear Heavenly Father. Be with all caretakers, dear Lord. Just grant everyone peace, patience, and comfort. For we know, Lord, that all of these come through you. For it is in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. I would also like to read a few passages from Psalms 136, wherein it's mentioning that we give thanks to the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Oh, give thanks unto the God of gods, for his mercy endureth forever. Oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his mercy endureth forever. To him who alone doeth great wonders, for his mercy endureth forever. To him that by wisdom made the heavens, for his mercy endureth forever. To him that stretched out the earth above the waters, for his mercy endureth forever. To him that made great lights, for his mercy endureth forever. The sun to rule by day, for his mercy endureth forever. The moon and stars to rule by night, for his mercy endureth forever. To him which led his people through the wilderness, for his mercy endureth forever. Who giveth food to all flesh, for his mercy endureth forever. O give thanks unto the God of heaven, for his mercy endureth forever. And these passages of scripture were from Psalm 136, verses 1 through 9, verse 16, verse 25 and 26.
Any of you that might need the nursery use, it's in the back here, and they'll take care of you. Little fellows. And if there's anyone that has something they would like to share with us, testimony, and let us know how your week has been, we'd love to hear from you.
Good morning, church. I'm thankful for little kids. I'm not a biological grandparent by any means, but Clo-Clo and Elena mean the world to me. And if you're a grandparent, raise your hand. If you're a grandparent, raise your hand. Look around and see all the, if you're a grandparent-to-be, raise your hand. All right, Leroy, all right. When I hear people talk about their grandparent, being a grandparent, or talking about their grandkids, their face just lights up. They do. It's just nothing. I don't think I've ever heard a grandparent say anything bad about their grandchild. Now, you start talking about the children, it's a whole lot of different. It's a different story. I saw a shirt one time that said, if I knew grandparenting would be so much fun, I would have had the grandkids first. Okay. I'm saying all that to say this. A couple weeks ago, it was my birthday. And when I got home from work, I walked in the house, and Elaine and Clo-Clo met me at the door with birthday cards. And they were cards that they made themselves. They colored them. And Clo-Clo's an artist. She's the five-year-old, but that girl can draw. And Elena put on the outside and just said, "I love you, Day, and these are things that you are." And she put giving, loving, and the last thing she put on it, she said, "Old." All right. So I opened it up, and Elena said, "I just thank you for all that you do for me." And she had $10 in it. This was $10 of her own money. Now, she doesn't work for a living. I don't know where she got it from. I'm sure Dust said he knows where she got it from. But this was $10 of her own money, and I tried to give it back to her, and she wouldn't take it. All right. And so then Clo-Clo brought me her card. She said, "Day, read mine." So she said, "Day, I love you." It said, "Day, I love you." And I opened it up, and it had a quarter taped inside of it so it wouldn't fall out. And I said, "Clo-Clo, was this your money?" She said, "No, I found it in the floor in my mama's kitchen." So you've got to love them. And that's what and the way we treat our grandkids and all of that, that's how we need to treat each other. That's how we talk about the things that we're thankful for and the material things. We need to be thankful for our people. Leroy and I had a conversation this morning about how we can be judgmental of people, how they look, how they act, their history, their past, maybe even their future. Sometimes we get jealous of people's successes, you know. But we need to be thankful for each other because we all created in God's image, aren't we? We all look like Jesus. We all look like God, right? I hope God's taller than me, but, you know, we need to be thankful of each other. And I think if we take that mentality, church, this world will be a better place to be. And I pray that you have a happy Thanksgiving, but let's take out the time to know the real. We talk about it at Christmas, but Thanksgiving is near and dear to me because of it's the start of the family season. I pray for those who this year will be the first time that empty chair. We talk about that empty chair. And it's some of those empty chairs are going to be fresh. Let's take that time to remember those people. Some of those empty chairs are going to be because of someone is in the hospital, okay? One empty chair may be because of relocation, because of jobs. There's several reasons for the empty chairs, but I hope we take the time and just, as they say, the real reason for the season. I ask God to, I'm going to pray for you guys, and I ask that you pray for me as we walk through this thing called life together. And I thank you for being who you are, church.
Anyone else?
Hi, good morning, church. I guess Darren was talking about an empty chair, and I'm going to have one this Thanksgiving that I wasn't expecting. And I really just wanted to express my thanks to all the people here at the church that sent their sympathy and their love and the food and everything else to support us and support me. And I just really, one thing I really noticed that hit me was that sometimes we get too comfortable with people and we forget to think about the, you know, we let go. We should say, "I love you" more. We should do more hugging. And all of a sudden, if they're gone, you can't do that anymore. And it's, you know, it just really hit me that we need to not let the barriers come up and anything that's in there, just get rid of it. And 'cause if we've got barriers in our heart for somebody, even if they're not big things, they're still going to interfere with our relationship with God too. So we just did not. Once again, I just really like to thank everybody for all the cards and support and prayers. Thank you.
Thank you there. Anyone else? If not, let us stand and sing a hymn number 4 and hymnal there. To God be the glory. Of course, it'd be up here too. You may be seated. At this time, on behalf of the pastor and myself, we would like to thank Leroy for volunteering to bring the message today, and we pray that God will bless him as he brings to us. Brother Leroy.
Good morning, church. I never can say it enough. Definitely not qualified to be here. I'm always humbled when I'm given the opportunity to speak. I spent the better half of my life probably teaching people stuff that they didn't need to know. But God still loves me anyway. So when Pastor Jay had asked me to speak, I guess probably been a month or so ago, I was in the midst of a crisis of my own, I guess you could say, of my own fruition. So I didn't accept right away. Normally, it's usually a no-brainer, you know. I'll accept opportunity. But I don't take this very lightly. It's very serious. Whether you want to believe it or not, lives are at stake, souls are at stake every single day of our lives. It was mentioned earlier. I don't think we say the little things enough. We take things for granted. We take people for granted. We think more about things and stuff than we do people, whether we want to admit it or not. And till those people are taken away from us. Then we realize, you know, we probably could have done a better job. So this morning, as we talk about Thanksgiving, my message, if I have to give it a title, is Every Day is a Day to Give Thanks. Sounds pretty easy, right? But how often do we really do it? Okay, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18 says, "Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." Being thankful or some form of thanksgiving is mentioned over 150 times in the Bible, therefore showing us how important and necessary giving thanks is in the life of Christ followers. I'm a numbers guy, okay? And I tried to find a specific number, but you would not believe how many contradicting facts there is when you try to look this up. How many times is it mentioned in the Bible? But one thing they came close to is somewhere around 150 times, over 150 times it's mentioned in the Bible about Thanksgiving. Our joy, prayer, and thankfulness should never fluctuate based on our ever-changing circumstances or situations, and surely not based on even more ever-changing feelings and emotions. Okay, our feelings and emotions, you know, they lie to us. And it's easy to fall victim to your feelings and emotion. You can be the most rational, common sense-based person in the world, but you let those feelings and emotions get in your head, and you'll throw them out the window quickly, like that cigarette somebody threw out here and set the field on fire. You'll get rid of it real quick. Our feelings and emotions are one of the devil's greatest tools in separating us from unity and fellowship with and in Christ. And let's face it, in the world we live in today, circumstances can change with lightning speed, and our emotions and feelings can change even faster. Okay? I don't care. I'm a planner, too, for the most part. I don't care how well your plan is. There's always going to be someone or something throwing a wrench in that plan. So you better be very adaptable. And if you're not adaptable, you can find yourself in harm's way pretty quick, pretty quick. It says, obeying these three commands given by Paul, be joyful, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances and situations are against our natural instincts. But as we make conscious, continual, and deliberate decisions to follow these commands, our perspective will change. And our will change our focus as we not only see God working in our circumstances, but also see our utter weakness to change things in our own strength. A lot of us think we're a whole heck of a lot stronger than we really are. I think about Mike Tyson. Mike Tyson said everybody's got a plan until they get punched in the mouth. And that punch in the mouth comes in a lot of different forms. So it's about us making decisions, okay? It says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Because Paul's not commanding us or trying to teach us that we must thank God for all of our circumstances, rather in all of our circumstances. There's a difference. You know, we're not thankful for the inconveniences in our life. And that's not what he's asking us to do. But we can be thankful in spite of those situations. Okay? And it's easier said than done. It says, evil never comes from God, so we should not thank him for it. Okay? So we don't thank him for those things that hold us up, those things that get us aggravated, those things that push those red buttons for us. Okay? We don't thank him for those. Well, we can be thankful in those times. It says, but when evil strikes, and it will, we can still be thankful for his presence and for the good he will accomplish in and through our distress, whether solicited or unsolicited. Okay, I'm going to tell on myself today as I get further along. I consider myself to be fairly transparent. Not so transparent over the last year and a half. Okay, so today's word is will be a partial testimony, and it's, you know, what I feel like God has laid on my heart. Some ministry opportunities have been opened up that have been at the forefront, not just here in our church, but, you know, in society because of this. And as unwelcoming as they may be and as uncomfortable as they may be, conversations that may have to be had, I'm finally ready to do what I think he's called me to do. Okay, so in just a few short days, we'll celebrate Thanksgiving Day, you know, time off from our jobs, time spent with family and loved ones, not to mention time for some tasty dishes we look forward to indulging in, okay? But it should be a time of reflection. You know, this is a time, you know, are we thankful? What are you thankful? We say we're thankful for a lot of things, but are we really? How do we show it? Again, you know, words, you know, if that's all they are, they're just words and they're empty. They mean nothing. They don't touch people. It's sad and absolute shame that we only have one day set aside each year to give thanks to God as a nation. Thanksgiving should be a daily occurrence, giving praise to him who's blessed us so richly. And I like what William Arthur Ward says. He says, God gave you a gift of 86,400 seconds today. Have you used one to say thank you? 86,400 seconds in a day. So out of those 86,400 seconds of a day, how many of them are you really thankful? How many times do you really say thank you? In years past, you know, respect was something that we taught our kids. When you didn't say thank you or open a door or something, things of that nature for some people, you get called out on it. But now it's just something that's just completely overlooked. It's like it doesn't even exist. Miss Lisa was talking about it this morning in Sunday school about just the utter disrespect that people have today. Okay, you didn't see it so open and so rampant 30 years ago, but now it's just like a way of life. You know, it's like respect is completely forgotten, and thankfulness sure is too. Okay, so even more so, I love another quote from H.A. Ironside, who lays out an attitude and practice that should be at the core of every follower of Christ, not to mention it can change the very nature of how we approach all of our circumstances, good, bad, ugly, and everything in between, when he said, "We could worry less if we praise more. Thanksgiving is the enemy of discontent and dissatisfaction." The more we apply Paul's commands, William Ward and H.A. Ironside's thoughts to our everyday lives, giving thanks, the less we have to complain about. Okay, whatever we occupy ourselves with the more of, that means we're pushing something else out the way. So if we deliberately choose to be thankful, if we deliberately choose to stop and reflect, in the middle of a crisis or something unfavorable, let's just say it don't have to be a crisis, unfavorable, you're stuck at the stoplight and this went through three changes and you ain't left yet, find something to be thankful for. Deliberately, it has to be deliberate, because it's not, we're not naturally inclined to be thankful. We're not naturally inclined to recognize our blessings, much less thank somebody for them. Because as I've said all too many times, we're like Burger King and we always want it our way. Each and every one of us, whether we admit it or not. So the more we apply those commands Paul gave us, the more our perspective will change, the more we will be more likely to be thankful versus not. So once we've learned to give thanks, we can invite God into our situations for him to take charge. And with this act, we're handing everything over to him in his hands. Because believe you me, I don't care how many muscles you got. I don't care how many brains you think you have or how smart you think you are. Like Mike Tyson said, life will punch you in the mouth and it'll change your thought process really quick. Even with somebody like me who has a plan. I've shared this before, because of the way I've been over the years and the things that I indulged in. Wherever I go, even in church on Sunday, when I sat down, I need to know where all the exits are. I usually put my back against the wall when I can. That way I can see everything's going on, so I can have an exit strategy in case I need, in case something pops off and I got to get out. And the reason for that is because I put myself in a situation where I always had to be looking over my shoulder. I had this guilt deep down inside that somebody or something was coming to get me for something I done done. You can't be thankful in a situation like that. And I think a lot of us have not come to that reality yet. I hope and pray that you don't find that reality like I found it myself, because you don't have to. We often talk about having an attitude of gratitude, and this is something that is contrary to every one of our natural instincts. Our default setting seems to be naturally ungrateful, even when we get what we thought we wanted, and even more so when we don't have it our way. Much like the Israelites we read about in the Old Testament, we take things for granted, we murmur. It's a word that's used frequently in the Old Testament, murmur. You don't hear nobody say it now. Murmur. And we complain on a regular basis when things don't go as we planned or thought they should. We naturally look at what's wrong without giving any thought to what's right or what's good. We're always looking for what's wrong instead of what's good. And trust me, when you're looking for what's wrong and what's not good, it's plenty of it to be found. It's not in our natural inclination to do that. So we have to be deliberate about it. We have to be mindful of it every second of every hour of every day. Otherwise, we'll continue to repeat the same patterns that we lived through and learned up until this point. We'll keep doing them over and over. It seems that most of the time we see the glass half empty rather than half full. But here's a shocker. We should be thankful that we even have a glass at all. And even more so, the glass can be refilled. Again, we always look to what's wrong versus what's good and what's right. So we're absolute experts at finding the things that are wrong. We don't automatically count our blessings or even recognize them for that matter. I've shared this on many occasions with my Sunday school class. In my opinion, the church is very good at telling the world what we're against instead of what we're for. And we're losing ground for it. We're basically pointing out what everybody else is doing wrong instead of showing them how to do it right. The church universal as a whole, we've lost a lot of ground because of that. The first thing we want to do is tell people what we don't believe in, what's not right, instead of showing them what we do believe in and showing them what is right. We could gain a lot of footing back if our actions really showed that we believe this God that we say we love, if we believe God's word that we say we love. But we've lost a lot of ground because we're not practicing what we say we believe in. We tend to focus on the negative in our lives, our families, our churches, and the world we live in, and that's no good for anyone. Again, like the Israelites I mentioned earlier, instead of being people of gratitude and thankfulness, we fall prey to grumbling and complaining, looking no different than the world around us. And when we don't look any different than the world around us, what's going to draw them closer to Christ? Not a thing. Not a thing. And we're very good at it. And I'm not standing here in my ivory tower or my glass house throwing stones, but like Paul, I consider myself chief of sinners, guilty as charged. I'm not up here trying to be holier than thou. This message is for me. I've been wrestling with this for a year and a half. And I've lost a lot of ground because of it. I've hid from things. I've missed opportunities. Because in my mind, I wasn't qualified. In my mind, I had no right, no business trying to offer anybody help that even though in the midst of the situation I was in, the advice that I could have given would have been good. It would have been right. It would have been God's word. It would have been God's will. But I didn't share it because I was ashamed. I was guilty. I was running. And let me just let y'all in on a little advice. I don't know if we got any sprinters in here or any runners in here. But I don't care how good you can run. Ben, I don't care how fast your car is. You can't outrun God. He He might allow you to run for a long time. But sooner or later, you got to pay the piper. He's going to be there. But I want to remind y'all, in spite of all of that, like we talked about in Sunday school this morning, he's a loving God. In spite of who we are, in spite of what we do, he still loves us, he still cares for us, and he still wants us to stop and turn around. Okay, so there's hope. All right? We naturally look for what's wrong without giving any thought to what's right and good. That's continual. That's something that we do over and over and over again. So I ask you this morning, how many professional grumblers do we have with us this morning? Some of us grumble and complain like it's our job and we get paid for it. Can't wait to get up and start complaining. Waiting for that check to come in the mail. You know, we're professionals when it comes to that. Just imagine for 1 second if we turned that profession into professional thanksgivers, what the difference might look like. I'm sure all of us know people who seem to have quite the opposite attitude, as it was mentioned in Sunday school this morning again. People who seem to be ever so cheerful, full of life, always encouraging and uplifting. Let me tell you, if you know somebody like that, they're working hard to be like that because it's not naturally in us. And I can tell you, those people that you see that are naturally trying to encourage people and uplift them, uplift other people, they've been through some stuff. They done seen some things. They've experienced some pain. They've experienced some hurt. And at the core, they don't want to see anybody else experiencing it. So don't think they're just naturally do-gooders. They're just naturally nice. They're just naturally encouraging. They're just naturally strong. They're working hard at it. At some point in their life, they done paid a heavy price to be that way. And they don't want to see anybody else afflicted with that. So they're working hard at it. They're working on exhibiting the things that Paul exclaimed in 1 Thessalonians. These are the people who have tapped into Paul's command to give thanks in all circumstances. Paul's telling us that thanksgiving is not just about looking for the positive in situations and circumstances. It's even more important to recognize, and if you don't hear anything else, hear this. It's even more important for us to recognize who walks with us and is it present in all our situations and circumstances. That's what we can be thankful for. We can be thankful for, regardless of whether we got in our situation because of our own fault, or we just got caught up in life itself, he's still with us. He still wants the very best for us. He wishes us no harm. His presence is still with us whether we brought it on ourselves or not. C.S. Lewis talks about how being thankful is woven into a life of worshiping God and our tendency to thank him for what he has done for us, all the blessings he's bestowed upon us, specifically the gift of salvation through Jesus, which is great, and we should count our blessings, but at the very heart of our thankfulness as his followers, it's not just what he has given us, but we should give thanks simply for who God is. If he didn't give any of us anything else, and we all live to be 1,000 years old, he would have already given us enough, and that's something to be thankful for. But remember what I said earlier. We're not naturally thankful. And even if he did give us something brand new that we've never seen, each day up into those 1,000 years up, guess what? We still complain. There would still be something else that we wanted. So it's not always about getting what we want. It's who's with us and whose presence is in us in spite of those situations and circumstances. That's what we have to recognize. C.S. Lewis says, knowing who we are thanking leads us to a life saturated with thanksgiving, and listen to this, thanks living, which translates to a life of worship, gratitude, thanks, and fellowship with the one true God. I mentioned earlier the premise of having an attitude of gratitude, but thanksgiving is far more of an action than an attitude. Thanksgiving is one thing, but thanks living is a whole new ball game. Thanks living is when those words, you know, the rubber hits the road. It's when your life shows other people that no matter how hard Mike Tyson punches you in the mouth, you're still going to get back up, and you're going to be thankful that you was able to get back up. It's possible. It's not natural. It's not in us to naturally get back up and wait for that next punch. But it's possible if we deliberately choose to give thanks, if we deliberately choose to look for the good in a situation versus the bad. Bryn Brown, a leading author, writes in her book, The Gifts of Imperfection, she says she can have a yoga attitude. Okay, she's got yoga pants, she's got a yoga mat, she's got a water bottle, but she's never done yoga. How many of us got all those tools in the garage or the tools in the shed and ain't never worked on nothing in their life? Well, you can have all the tools you want. Don't make you a mechanic. And just like Bryn Brown, you can have all the yoga stuff you want. If you're not practicing yoga, you're not going to be a yogi. Says she hasn't put her yoga attitude into yoga action. How many of us have put our words into action? It's easy for us here every Sunday. It's easy for us on Wednesday nights, Thursday nights, whatever night we meet, you know, where we just take a little piece of the pie, a piece of the day, and, you know, give it to God. We come and meet in fellowship and unity. It's easy to do it then, but what about the rest of the time? I'm going to go out on a limb here, and I think I played devil's advocate a couple times this morning in Sunday school, and I'm going to play devil's advocate again. I'm pretty sure the majority of us sitting here this morning devote more of our time to things that we think we like or claim to like versus spending that same amount of time reading God's word and sharing God's word with other people. I think it's pretty safe to say most of us can check that box off. So our words have to be active, you know, so that's why I like thanks living. You know, thanksgiving can be turned into thanks living. If we claim we have a heart of thanksgiving, if we claim to be thankful for Jesus in our lives, but find ourselves constantly complaining, constantly irritated, angry, or ungrateful for just about everything and everyone, what's going to be the world's conclusion about us? Even worse, the God that we claim and love, the God that we claim to follow, what's the world going to think? If we're never showing any thankfulness, if we're just letting our circumstances and situations dictate, our reactions show that we're ungrateful, our reactions show that we're angry, we're irritated, what is the world going to think? Especially when we claim that we love God and we know God. I'm going to tell you, it's pretty evident. Look around. Look at the media. Look at the news. Nobody needs God. Nobody wants God. Remember earlier when I said we've lost a lot of ground because we tell people what we don't believe in versus show them what we do believe in? That's why we've lost a lot of ground. Timothy Keller says it's one thing to be grateful, it's another to give thanks. Gratitude is what you feel. Thanksgiving is what you do. Thanksgiving has to be an inward heart attitude with an outward practice. An outward practice. It has to be an action. Paul was not unfamiliar with the hardships of life. He faced many hardships that you and I may prayerfully never face ourselves. He was imprisoned, persecuted, beaten, and shipwrecked among many other undesired, unwanted, and unsolicited circumstances and situations. And most of his were due to the fact that he proclaimed Christ. Even in prison, he's giving God praise. He's praising God. I'm pretty sure it's safe to say that none of us would be praising God if we were locked up. And I have been. And I won't praise him. I won't praise him at all. He was no stranger to tragedies. The Christian life isn't a permanent mountaintop experience. If we walk with God long enough, we're going to go through some things that we would never wish on our worst enemy. But on the other hand, be ever so thankful and grateful because we got to know God on a deeper level. The church has heard me say this before. Anything that brings you to your knees and your first inclination to go to God is, that's something to be thankful for. Because you've recognized your weakness. You recognize that you're powerless on your own. And you recognize that the one person who can change your situation is the very person that you've decided to call on. How many other times have we called on people who were defenseless to help us with anything, but maybe get mired up more in their situation, circumstance? We're quick to do that. Some people get on Facebook and blast it all over. They got pictures to show it. We'll share with everybody in the world our distress and don't even think about calling God. Don't even think about sharing it with the only person that can help us. We learn to be thankful in and during hard times, even though we're not thankful for the hard times. It can always be worse. As cliche as that sounds, it can always be worse, and that's something to be thankful for. Paul nor God himself are commanding us to be thankful for a lost job, a loss of a loved one, a betrayal, a financial hardship, sickness, or terminal illness. But we are commanded to be in a perpetual state of thanksgiving in spite of those hardships and tragedies. We are commanded to look for the brighter side. Scripture tells us that he can use those tragedies for good. The situation I find myself in now of my own fruition has opened up some opportunities, some ministry avenues that I've been running from for a long time. I knew they were there. Well, I say, pal, said, sometimes I put your hand up. I know you're there, God, but I'm not going to really pay that much attention right now. I got other more important stuff. I've been doing that for a while. Okay, so that's something to be thankful for. To be thankful for the fact that he didn't leave me in my misery where I was wallowing in, enjoying and partying in. I'm having a good time wallowing in it. Thankful that he didn't leave me there because he could have. Thankful that he didn't answer me when I cried out. Thankful that even though I waited to the last possible second to call him, he still answered the phone. He still picked up that call. He didn't let it ring and go to voicemail. That's something to be thankful for. Trust me when I tell you, it's easier said than done. I myself have ran from God and everyone else who could have and would have helped me in my time of need over the last year and a half. I turned to self-medicating, ultimately being painfully reminded of my inability to fix my own problems and my own strength. That word we talk about a lot, that pride, that ego. I'm not trying to be chauvinist today, but I can't speak for the women, but I can speak for the men. You know, we've been taught to be macho. We got to be bad. We got to take on everything. We got to hold everything on our shoulders. I don't know who started all that macho bull crap. Forgive me. But there's no place for it in God's kingdom. Don't be like me and find out the hard way. I didn't ask for help. I reached out and searched for things that I thought would help me. Some of it the world said would help. I bought into it. It helped all right. It helped me get further along that road than I wanted to go. It helped all right. So again, it's easier said than done. Okay? It's only after I bottomed out, or as most people say, have heard before, hit rock bottom with no other way to go but back up, that I realized that if I'd just been thankful, if I just recognized God's hand in my life at every painful turn, if I had just asked for help, things could have turned out different. But all's not lost. It's because of my situation, it's because of the God I know, that I now have new energy and new conviction to give thanks in spite of my situation, because of God, who God has been, continues to be, and will forever be, in not just my life, but in your life as well. If we choose to trust and love Him. The same is true for you as true for me. Whatever you're going through today, I may not know your specific pain, but I am sure that I know a God who does. I am sure that right now you're rubbing shoulders with brothers and sisters in Christ that may know a little bit about your situation. They may not know your situation. They may not know your pain. But they know a little bit about it because they've suffered some of the same inconvenience, some of the bad circumstances. Don't be like me and not look for help in the right place. You're not here by chance this morning. You're not here because I invited you to be here. Because as it said, Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, you could have chose not to be here. So whatever your reason was to be here, remember, we don't have to be thankful for the bad situations, the bad circumstances, but we can be thankful in them. That's what Paul's trying to tell us. God puts people in our lives that can help us in our situations. I used to think a long time ago, you know, why do I want somebody who's had 5 failed marriages? Why do I want somebody who's been in rehab 15 times? Why do I want somebody who's filed bankruptcy 3 times to give me any advice? Well, you know what the positive side to that is? They are experts in all of those fields, and they can tell you or show you what you don't need to do. So that's the flip side to that. They've been through it, maybe still going through it. But they do still have something to offer. It's up to us to choose whether we see it and listen to it. I'm by no means thankful for the turn of events that led me to the most unwanted, unexpected, and undesired circumstances that I'm currently facing. And if you've heard nothing else today, please hear this. The same Jesus that saved me in spite of all that I am and am not knows pain and suffering that none of us would ever be able to endure, and that's something worth being thankful for. in spite of who we are, in spite of the things we choose, instead of choosing him, he still loves us. He still wants us. He's still present with us. And that is something to be thankful for. If you're not thankful for anything else, you can be thankful for that. That empty seat we were talking about, when you can't talk to that person that's in that empty seat, guess who you can talk to? You can talk to God. Okay, that's not going to ever change unless we choose not to. God's ear is always open. He's always ready to hear from us. That's something to be thankful for. While we may hope and pray that he removes us out of our unwanted situations and circumstances, what I can assure you of, much like Paul had come to realize, I've come to realize myself, even if he does not remove us from our situation, he will always be with us as his word promises us. He will never leave nor forsake us. That's something to give thanks for. It's a promise that I guarantee you and promise that he will always uphold. He'll never leave or forsake us in spite of who we are. And that is something to be thankful for every second of every hour of every day that he gives us. Whether we're experiencing high times or hard times, one thing's constant, his presence. His presence is always there if we're willing to recognize it, if we're willing to call out to him. So I don't know what 2023 or previous years have held for you, nor do I know what 2024 has in store for you and I. But like Paul wants you to know, and I want you to know, as God was with us, is with us now, and he'll be with us. He will be there in days to come. That's not going to change. And that's something to be thankful for. That's something to look forward to in spite of unwanted circumstances and situations. Han Lot says the key to thankfulness is not to view God through the lenses of our circumstances, which we're all good at that. We want to look at God through our circumstances. And that translates, why did you let this happen to me? Why am I going through this? What did I do to deserve this? We're looking through it through our circumstances. But to view circumstances through the lenses of God's love and sovereign purpose, then things change. We don't want to look at them through God's eyes, because guess what we got to do? When we look at that mirror in the morning, we got to look at the person that's looking back at us. When we look at it through God's eyes, we got to self-reflect. That can be painful sometimes. There's absolutely no escape in trials and tribulations while we live on a sin-cursed planet brought on by a very man himself. No one, not one of us, gets a free, easy ride through life. Even the most seemingly happiest, cheerful, encouraging, and serving people have known and still know their share of sorrow, misery, and pain, some more than others. And none of us are capable of giving true thanks outside of the Holy Spirit's help. We look at Thanksgiving as a time to come together. We talked this morning, you know, Thanksgiving. What are some conversations that you want to steer away from at Thanksgiving because you know it's going to turn into an argument? And Thanksgiving should be a time to come together and truly be thankful. If we choose to look for things that are wrong, there's plenty of it out there. But as I'm asking you today, is to do like Paul has commanded us to do, is look for things to be thankful for. And when we begin to look for those things to be thankful for, I promise you, our situations might not immediately get better. Our circumstances might not immediately get better, but our perspective to look to God and to call upon Him will change our perspective on being thankful. We talk about it could always be worse, and it could. And that seems like it might be a default setting. But if that's the only default setting that you can use to look for thanks, then use that. And use it repeatedly. Use it continually. Because sooner or later, it'll be a habit to you. And once it becomes a habit to you, it'll be something that you do. And you do often. And I've said this many times before. Unfortunately, I found myself on the wrong side of it. We hear bad habits are hard to break, but good habits are hard to break. When you know it works, and it works 100 times out of 100, how can somebody convince you to do it different? They can't. So good habits are hard to break, even more so than bad habits. So make it a habit of looking for the good in things. Turn that thanksgiving into thanksgiving. Turn what you say into what you do. And that's when our thanksgiving will turn into thanksgiving. Again, Paul's not commanding us to be happy for those inconveniences and the bad things in lives, but he's letting us know that he found out that even in the midst of them, he can give thanks in the situation because he knows who's got him in his hands. The same is true for us. But when we, like Paul and many others throughout the Bible, add God to the equation, here's the key. God has to be part of the equation. Then and only then do we stand on ground solid enough to say, "Thank you, Lord," no matter what happens around us or to us. Lost people may never listen to a sermon or care to understand a doctrine that we believe in, but one thing they do notice and pay attention to is how we react and live under the pressures of life. They pay attention to our reactions. If we say we're Christians, if we say we believe God, if we say we trust His Word, they pay attention to your reactions. When that Mike Tyson punch comes, they want to see what your reaction is. And if your reaction looks like everybody else's, it looks no different than anything they've ever seen, they're not going to want to be a part of this God that you say you believe in, that I say I believe in. The world around us watches us ever so closely to see if our religion works during times of darkness and despair as it does during the sunlight and good times. They want to know, do we still have that same faith when the world's burning up around us? So now more than ever, it's important to turn our thanksgiving into thanksgiving. Again, I know it's easier said than done, but don't be like me. You don't have to. I tell my son all the time, you don't have to make the same mistakes I made. That's why our testimonies are so important. You don't have to be hard-headed and dumb like me. You don't have to, don't touch that eye, it's hot, and first thing you do is put your hand on it. You don't have to be like me. You can look at that blister on my hand and say, I don't want that. That's why our testimonies are so important. That's why our reactions, how we react, are so important. And the world is clearly watching us. If Christ still shines through us when we've been broken down by life, they may see our faith as a desired tool for their battle in life and make a decision to believe, follow, and love the same God we serve. If they see us living this Thanksgiving we claim to know, then and only then will they might want to be a part of it. But it's because we're not living out that thanks every day. It's because those words, we haven't put, you know, we haven't laced our boots up to those words and put them to work. We haven't made those actions real. Then they don't see a need for it. But when they see us bounce back after hitting rock bottom, when they see us give God glory and give God the praise for what He and only He could do, then and only then might they want a little bit of what we have. Again, I'm not up here throwing stones. I'm not on top of no ivory tower because I have not lived the Thanksgiving. But something to be thankful for is in spite of me, in spite of decisions I have made, His love for me is no less today than it was when He first saved me. It's even greater today than it was then. He wants the absolute best for you and me. We've been challenged on more than one occasion by my brother in Christ, Darren Holmes, and C.S. Lewis also reminds us and challenges us when he says, "May our thank yous be greater than our pleases." Our thank yous greater than our pleases. We have a laundry list of things that we want prayers for, right? People we want to pray for. How often do our thank yous look like a laundry list? Because I can guarantee you this, if you truly, truly make a decision to write down all the things that you should be thankful for, that prayer list wouldn't come nowhere close to that thank you list. If He does nothing else for us for the rest of our lives, He would have already done enough, and that's enough to be thankful for. This Thanksgiving, when we're sitting around our table, remember that there's always something to be thankful for. I found myself in a bad accident this year. Nice vehicle, blood, sweat, and tears put into it, a lot of money invested in it. It all disappeared in seconds. And I can honestly say, when I got out of that vehicle, my first inclination, believe it or not, was to thank God that I was still alive. And my second inclination was to thank God that He didn't allow me to hurt somebody else. So in the midst of that, it was something very thankful to be thankful for, and I was. And that's only the Holy Spirit, only the Holy Spirit. Because I'm one of the most selfish, prideful, egotistical fools you'll ever meet. I tell myself I'm not. I try not to be. But at the end of the day, and I self-reflect, pride. Or they say pride comes before the fall. But even in the midst of that situation and circumstance, I was thankful that I was alive. I was thankful that I didn't hurt nobody. That's how we have to be. In the midst of our tragedies, we have to give credit where credit is due. And all the credit, glory, and honor belongs to God. I don't care how successful we are in our jobs, how successful we are in our families, how successful we are in any part of our life. It's only because of God. In the very moment that you think it ain't, guess what? Mike Tyson's ready to punch you in the mouth. Life can change a situation in the blink of an eye. So that's why we have to be thankful. When we begin to at least balance our praises with our prayers, we'll begin to the process of perpetual thanksgiving in our daily lives, prayerfully equaling a visual that the world sees loud and clear. Remember those professional grumblers I was talking about? We all fall victim to that. So the next time somebody, you know, tries to pull you aside, oh, did you see what Hilda was doing? Did you see what happened to Hilda? The next time that happens, walk away from it. Don't be a part of it. That murmuring, you know, shows up, gossip. Don't be a part of it. It's not in our natural instincts to walk away from those things. Reggie, we say we always try to be the smartest man in the room, the smartest person in the room. So I want to know everything. I'm a glutton for it. But sometimes when we let that negative energy in, we push out the positive energy. We don't leave any room for the good because we filled it up with all the bad. And believe you me, that changes how we think. That changes how we react, and the world sees that. That's what they're looking for. So begin to balance your prayers with praise this Thanksgiving. I'm not going to lie to y'all. My family has come together, and we've made jokes about, you know, what are you thankful for? What are you thankful for? We made jokes about it. But it's an essence that we're missing, you know, to truly be thankful. It's the very little things that we enjoy every day in life. Like was shared earlier, we don't say I love you enough. We don't say thank you enough. We take people for granted. And that's something we have to be mindful of. And that's the only way that we're ever going to live Thanksgiving out, is to be mindful of all the things that we're thankful for. So balance your prayers. God wants us to come to Him. He wants us to pray. He wants us to talk to Him about those situations and circumstances that we don't like, even though He already knows them. But He wants us to come to Him. Nobody else. He wants us to come to Him. Now, I'm not saying He doesn't place people in our lives that can help us, because He does. We talked about angels. I believe in angels. We have no idea the number of things that God has saved us from, or God has placed somebody in our life. You know, that car that's running 5 miles an hour on a 50-mile-an-hour road, and then you get 2 miles down the road and it's a 9-car pileup. You know how many times I have to thank God in the morning that I didn't hit them 25 deer I seen? He's right at the edge of the road and he's playing peekaboo. It's too late for me to slow down. That's something to thank God of. And I do. I'm like, thank you, Lord, that He did not come out in front of me. So there's plenty to thank God for. So I'll close with this. Rick Warren said it best. Happy moments, praise God. Difficult moments, praise God. Quiet moments, worship God. Painful moments, trust God. Every moment, thank God. That moment can be taken away from us at any given time. None of us, you, me, and everybody in between, is promised tomorrow. Do you want to be known for being a professional grumbler? Or do you want to be known as being thankful? I can tell you what God wants. God wants us to be thankful. Nothing hurts Him even more than when we don't give Him the honor and praise that He deserves. Think about it for yourself. Think about it for me. When you do something for somebody and they don't say thank you, we might pretend like it doesn't bother us, but it does. And what does it do? It makes us think twice about doing it for the next person. That's not what God wants for us. Again, I'd like to thank Pastor Jay for this opportunity to share, because if you know like I know, it's not easy giving up the pulpit. If you're called to be a man of God, if you're called to be a woman of God, and it's your position to tend the sheep, you don't like giving up your spot. Okay? Again, I'm humbled. I'd like to thank him. I'd like to thank y'all for being here. And again, I'd close with exactly what Paul says. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. We don't have to be thankful for, but we are commanded to be thankful in. There's a difference. There's a big difference. Again, I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what pains you're suffering. I don't know what your financial situation or any of that. And I don't need to know. But what I want you to leave here today knowing is there's brothers and sisters in here right now that are willing to hear you and help you. And even greater, we serve a God who can meet your need if you're willing to truly give it to him. Not partially. What did the gentleman say a month or so ago? Not give 80%, give 100%. Because if we don't give it all to him, he can't fix it all. So we have to give it to him and be thankful he can fix it. So this Thanksgiving, truly reflect on what we have to be thankful for. Because there's always somebody worse off than we are. And as cliche as that sounds, again, I can't say it enough. If that's the only thing that will cause you to look for the good or the thanks, then use it. So be it. But there's always something to be thankful for. I thank y'all for y'all's attention today, and I hope, regardless of your situation or circumstance, that you do turn to God. Give it to God. Don't wait till it's too late. We're not promised our next breath. Please pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time that you've allowed us to come together. Father, I thank you for sight, sound, and touch, sound mind, and able body. Father, I thank you for all your blessings, known and unknown. I thank you for being with us, Lord, and wanting the very best for us. I thank you for loving us in spite of who we are. I thank you for loving us in spite of being natural complainers. Lord, I ask that you would impress upon us a heart and a desire to come to you in thanks in all situations. I'd ask that you would impress us to lean on your Holy Spirit and not lean on our own understanding, Father, because our feelings and our emotions, they lie to us. The devil uses them. It's his best weapon against your word, Lord. And I just ask that you would touch the hearts of each individual who is here and the family that they represent, Lord, that this Thanksgiving, that we might truly be Thanksgiving, and not just Thanksgiving Day, Lord, but each day that we might give you thanks, the honor and glory that you deserve, rightfully so, for everything that you've done for us, everything that you continue to do for us, and what you've promised to do for us in the future, Lord. Help us not take any of that for granted. Father, I ask that as we leave this place, that you would grant us with the same mercy and grace, traveling mercy and grace that allowed us to get here this morning as we travel to our various homes. And Father, I would ask you in the days and weeks and months to come, if it is your will, that we might show the world that we are different, that our thanksgiving might show up every day in our thanksgiving. Father, again, we ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Thank you. Amen. Our closing hymn for the day will be Alleluia, and Miss Lenore is going to close us out after that. If you've never given your life to Christ, if you've never made a confession of faith, please don't leave here today without doing so. It's said Sunday after Sunday. We're not promised our next second. The next breath is not promised. Don't leave here. If you have a heavy heart, if the Holy Spirit is on you this morning and you're ready to make that confession of faith, please do so. Don't leave this place without making it known. As we play our closing song, I'll be up front and some of the deacons will be around in the church. If you have a prayer or you want to give yourself to Christ today, please do so.
Let's pray together. Father God, we're so grateful for this day. We're grateful for who you are. We're to give all our praise to you. All honor and glory goes to you. We just said the word hallelujah. And hallelujah, which is a form of Father, it means all praises to Yahweh. That's you. Father, thank you for the word that we heard today, for Leroy being an instrument that you wanted to use. I know he was kicking and screaming probably, but you used him anyway, in spite of the objections he may have had, but you used him. I pray, Father, that you will use every single one of us, because we are called for a purpose, and that purpose is to bring honor and glory to you. So please let us be willing to do that. May we remember who you are in our lives, whether you've been Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Shalom, Prince of Peace, the Great Comforter, the Holy One. There are so many names and purposes that you fill in our lives that we fail to acknowledge that. I pray that this week, today, will be the beginning, a new time for us to call out all of the wonderful things that you do for us. And above all, Father, we praise you and thank you for Jesus. It is his blood that washes over every single one of us. We look perfect to you. In spite of all of the things we've done, Jesus' blood was shed for us so that we can have an eternal relationship with you. And it's in Jesus' holy name that we pray. Amen.